Second question, consider the following statements with respect to different sectors. So what is the difference between primary, secondary and tertiary sector? Primary sector deals with extraction of raw material from the earth. It may be minerals, it may be vegetables, it may be crops. And secondary sector deals with processing of this primary sector goods. And the tertiary sector is going to provide services for both primary and secondary sector activities. So here answer is, first one, manufacturing of ATM will not come under service sector. It is manufacturing of ATM. It comes under manufacturing sector. Mining of iron will come under primary, but converting into steel will not come under primary sector. Converting into steel will come under manufacturing sector. Manufacturing of wooden furniture comes under secondary sector. That's a true statement. So here, which among these statements are not correct? So answer is 1 and 2 only. Fourth question with respect to Saubhagya scheme. It aims to provide electricity connection to willing households in both rural and urban areas. That's a similar scheme which is called as Dinadayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana, which aims to give rural electrification. But according to definition for electrification in village, when 10% of households are getting electricity access and all public places in that village is getting electricity access, in that situation that village is considered to be electrically connected. But there is a gap in that particular scheme which is being plugged by Saubhagya scheme, because it's assumed that there are 100 people in a village and 10 households are getting power connection and remaining 90 is not getting power connection, and still according to the definition given, this village is going to be considered as it is having 100% access to electricity, but these 90 are not having access. And according to Saubhagya scheme, all the willing rural and urban households will be getting electricity connection. So answer is C. Fifth question with respect to MCA 21. In 2002, Ministry of Corporate Affairs planned to bring some website, a portal to communicate with the corporates, companies. So here 21 means 21st century. So it is related with e-governance. In that portal, there will be communication between the corporate affairs and also the companies. And remember, this data available in this MCA 21 is used by the Central Statistical Organization to calculate the GDP in new method. In the old method, the data was from annual survey of industries, and now it is from MCA 21. Your answer is B, e-governance. Seventh question with respect to real GDP growth is important for what? When real GDP grows, so when real GDP grows, when there is increase in production, when production increases, there will be more amount of goods and services. So there will be more taxable products, and also more production lead to more employment opportunities. So that will lead to more income, that will lead to more income tax revenue. So all this increase in revenue is going to reduce the deficit. So to reduce the deficit, it may be physical deficit or revenue deficit, this real GDP growth is going to be helpful. And also, as I said, this increase in production is going to result in increase in employment opportunities. So more people will be getting employment, and more people will be getting salary, and more people is going to increase their consumption level because of more salary, right? So that is going to lead in increase in demand. So all the three statements are correct. So answer is D, 1, 2 and 3 only. So consider the following statements with respect to producers price index. This is something similar to CPI and WPI, but this producer price index, when compared with CPI, WPI, this measures the change in the price value of the products within the factory. A product, first it is produced in a factory. When it is coming out to the market, taxes is added, marketing charges is added, logistical cost is added. Added to all, the price of the commodity is going to increase. And let's assume that the price of the commodity is 10 rupees. Increase in tax, increase in marketing charges, increase in logistics, that can also increase the price of the final good, let it say 20. When tax further increases, When logistical cost further increases, that might also increase the price of the final product. So the product, right, the price of the product increases. This might lead to inflationary situation, but here the inflation is due to the external factors, not because of the production cost. So if I want to know the change in the production side or change in the prices in the supplier's side, I will go for something called as producer's price index. It is the average change in the price of goods and services as they leave the place of the production. So when they will leave, when the product is being completed, that is stage, it will leave out of the factory. So what is the price change happening in that stage? That will be measured, that is called as producer's price index. And PPI measures the average change in prices excluding the indirect taxes, that is a true statement. So answer is C, both 1 and 2. 12th question with respect to GDP deflator. GDP deflator is also a measure, it's a tool to measure the inflation. GDP deflator takes into account of both goods and services, it's a true statement. GDP deflator does not include the price of export and imported goods, no. GDP deflator will exclude the price of imported goods, that is correct. GDP deflator takes into account of all goods and services produced within the economy. The goods which are meant for exports are also produced within the economy. So GDP deflator will include the goods which are being exported and it will exclude the goods which are being imported. So second statement is wrong. So answer is A, 1 only. 14th question. Increase in crude oil prices will have a large impact on CPI core. So what is core? When I calculate inflation without taking into account of price rise in the food, or without taking into account of food and fuel price rises, I calculate inflation without taking into account of the food and fuel prices. That is called as core inflation. So increase in crude oil price will not have any large impact on CPI core. Increase in HRA, increase in house rental allowance, will result in more money supply in the hand of public. Let's assume I am earning 10,000 rupees. Let's assume I am getting a HRA of 10,000 rupees. From tomorrow, I get a HRA of 25,000 rupees. So I look for better houses. The demand for better houses will increase. That might lead to inflationary situation. So increase in HRA can trigger inflation situation is the correct answer. So answer is B, 2 only. 16th question with respect to headline inflation. So headline inflation takes into account of everything. It also takes into account of impact of food, fuel. Difference between core and headline is core takes into account of inflation excluding the impact of food and fuel, and headline takes into account of everything. So statement 1 is correct. Headline inflation can be reduced by reducing import duties. That is a true statement. So why there is inflationary situation? When demand is more. Why there is more demand? Because there is no adequate production in the country. And there is no adequate production, there is more demand. So in order to reduce the prices, I have to bring products to meet the demand. So from where I can bring? The domestic market, the production is less. So I bring it from other countries. So I import the goods which are having price rise in order to reduce the inflationary effect. So to encourage more goods from other countries, I have to reduce the import. If import duties are increased, then that will not be helpful to purchase goods from other countries. So during inflationary situation, to meet the demand, I need to bring more products. So import is one way. So during inflationary situation, to facilitate the import duties will be reduced. So here, answer is both 1 and 2. 20th question, which among the following measures can be taken to reduce the revenue deficit? So what is revenue deficit? Revenue deficit is equal to revenue expenditure minus revenue receipt. Here, reduce. So how I can reduce the revenue deficit? Either by decreasing the revenue expenditure or either by increasing the revenue receipt, I can decrease the revenue deficit. Reducing subsidies, definitely that is going to reduce the revenue expenditure. Increasing the disinvestment proceeds. So disinvestment proceeds will come under something called as capital receipt. So this is going to play no role in reducing revenue deficit. And also market borrowings is an example for capital receipt. So 2 and 3 will not have any influence in reducing the revenue deficit. So answer is B, 1 only. So how to differentiate this capital receipt and revenue receipt? Remember, any receipt which increases, any receipt which increases the liability of the government, or it reduces the assets of the government. So look here, second statement, by disinvesting the government's stake, government is reducing its assets. By increasing the market borrowing, government is increasing or creating a liability, right? So both are examples of capital receipt. Any other receipt will fall under revenue receipt. So here answer is B, 1 only. 22nd question, FRBM review committee was headed by N.K. Singh, and we all know that he is the chairman of 15th Finance Commission. 24th question, with respect to consequence of high fiscal deficit. So when will I have high fiscal deficit? When my expenditure is more than my receipt, I'll be having higher fiscal deficit. So in order to finance that deficit, what government will do? Government will borrow from the market. When government borrows money from the market, the money available in the market for private investment will reduce. And also, as I said, government took large amount of money from the market in order to finance the deficit. So the money available in the market will reduce. When money reduces, when the supply of money reduces, the cost of the money will increase. That is nothing but increase in interest rates. And let's take a situation, government borrows that money and it goes for spending. That spending, after some time, it might create inflationary situation because of expanded money supply. Immediately that is going to reduce the private investment, and immediately there is going to be an increase in interest rates. But over a period of time, because of spending, because of excess of money supply, the inflation can increase, right? And this reduction in private investment due to the expenditure made by the government, or due to the money taken by the, available in the market by the government, is called as crowding out effect. Right? 26th question. When the raw material, the tax on the raw material is greater than the tax on the output, that is called as inverted duty structure. Look at here. The natural rubber is the raw material. The tax is higher when compared to the tax of the final product. This is a classical example for inverted duty structure. So answer is B. 29th question, with respect to physical stimulus. What is physical stimulus? During a low economic growth situation, to revive the economy, government will go for boosting more money supply to expand the demand so that production will increase, so that economy will grow. So this stimulus package is going to result in massive expansion of money supply in the economy. So government will increase the money supply by either spending more or by keeping the interest rates low. So by spending more, government's fiscal deficit is going to increase. It will not decrease. Statement one is wrong. Decrease in interest rates, of course, yes, government is going to spend more. Low interest rates is one way to bring in fiscal stimulus package. So second is correct. If not implemented properly, remember, the economy is growing properly. Assume there is an election coming up in near future. Anticipating the election, if government wants for expanding the money supply, if government wants to spend more, if it wants to bring more expenditure oriented programs, more subsidies, etc., in that case, that might lead to inflationary situation, because already economy is performing, and when the economic growth will be always coupled with small amount of inflation, adding to that, if government goes for expanding the money supply, that is going to result in inflationary situation. So here answer is 2 and 3. 31st question. So what is real GDP and what is nominal GDP? GDP calculated based on the constant prices in the base year. That is called as real GDP. GDP calculated based on the current prices is called as nominal GDP. Right? So when real GDP is greater than nominal GDP, it means that prices in the constant year was greater when compared to prices in the current year? So answer is Bombay. B, the price of goods and services in constant year are greater than prices in the current year. 33rd question, initial coin offering was sometime in news, that is with respect to bitcoins. The startups or companies which are engaged in the bitcoin business, now they want to encash the bitcoins into legal currencies, fiat currencies. So they went for something called as initial coin offering. That's why it was in news. And SEBI is thinking to regulate that ICO. Right? 34th question with respect to Gini coefficient. It indicates the inequality between rich and poor. Right? So what is Gini coefficient? How it is calculated? Gini coefficient takes the help of Lorentz curve. Let's say in x-axis I take population. In y-axis I go for wealth in terms of percentage. And this is going to be something called as Lorentz curve. At any point of time, this Lorentz curve is going to give the relationship between percentage of population who held proportionate wealth. Right? If this curve is a line, in that case, the line means the proportionate of population earned the wealth are equal, or there is an equality situation, and this line is called as line of equality. Now, what is Gini coefficient? It is the area above the Lorentz curve. So this is the area above the Lorentz curve. Area above Lorentz curve divided by area below the line of equality. It is the entire triangle area below the line of equality. So I bring line of equality. Let's assume line of equality. Let's assume line of equality is 2. Area of triangle is 2 units. Let's assume area above the Lorentz curve is 1 unit. I get 0.5. So when we will get 1? When the numerator and denominator is going to be of same value, that means the area above the Lorentz curve and the area below the line of equality should be the same. So for that, this Lorentz curve should be a curve of this form. When the Lorentz curve is of this form, the area above the Lorentz curve and the area below the line of equality will be same. And this is a situation I will get 1. And 1 is a situation where the economy is experiencing maximum inequality. And when will I get 0? When the area below the line of equality and area above the Lorentz curve should be 0. So when the area above the area above the Lorentz curve is going to be 0, when the area above the Lorentz curve matches with the line of equality. When the area above the Lorentz curve matches with the line of equality, I will get the value as 0. So how to match the line? Imagine this curve is getting reduced. This curve is getting reduced and it is being matched with the line of equality. When the Lorentz curve matches with the line of equality, in that situation, the area between line of equality and area between Lorentz curve and line of equality is going to be 0. In that case, when I take the ratio, I will get 0. So when Gini coefficient is 0, it means the economy is having perfect equality situation. When the Gini coefficient is 1, the economy is having inequality situation. So a general rise in Gini coefficient will not decrease the income inequality, it will increase the inequality. Progressive taxation can be a tool to increase, not the increase Gini coefficient. Progressive taxation is going to mitigate, it is going to reduce the differences in the income inequality between the rich and poor. So progressive taxation is a tool to decrease the Gini coefficient. So here I have asked about incorrect statements. Both are incorrect. So answer is C, both 1 and 2. 36th question. Which among the above statements will lead to increase in money supply? We already discussed higher fiscal deficit means higher expenditure, that will lead to money supply. One is correct. Issuance of treasury bill. By issuing the treasury bill, government is going to suck out the money supply from the economy. So that will decrease the money supply. Purchase of government securities. By purchasing the government securities from the public, government is going to pump in the money supply in the economy. That is going to increase the money supply. So here answer is C, 1 and 3 only. 38th question with respect to anti-dumping investigations. So whenever there is an anti-dumping like situation, the Director General of Anti-Dumping and Allied Duties will conduct an inquiry and it will submit the report to Ministry of Finance, and Ministry of Finance will impose anti-dumping duty for 5 years. But this Director General office will not come under Ministry of Finance, rather it comes under Ministry of Commerce and Industries. So what is anti-dumping duty? This is to counterbalance the subsidy support given by the exporting country by importing country. Let's take India and China. Let's take India wants to import a pen worth 10 rupees from China. Now, China is giving large amount of subsidy and it makes sure that this pen is sold in India for 5 rupees. If that pen is available for 5 rupees in India, then that is going to affect our domestic pen manufacturers. So to counter this act, government will impose something called as anti-dumping duty so that the domestic business players are getting protected. So this anti-dumping duty is imposed to counterbalance the subsidy given by the exporting company by the importing India. So answer is B, 2 only. 48th question with respect to cross subsidy. So what is cross subsidy? It is subsidizing one segment at the cost of another segment. In order to give kerosene subsidy, government will tax petroleum diesel products at a higher cost. This is called as cross subsidy. So answer is B. 42nd question, wholesale price index, a monthly index, it is released by Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. Remember, CPI rural or CPI urban or CPI combined is released by CSO, but WPI is released by Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, which comes under Ministry of Commerce and Industries. 45th question, GDP includes goods which are meant for exports to, of course, yes, we already discussed, GDP takes into account of goods produced within the country. So the goods which are meant for exports is also produced within the country. So statement 1 is correct. There is a steady increase in GDP of India since 1981. That is a true statement. Since 1991, we were having a positive growth rate. So positive growth rate means GDP is increasing steadily. But growth rate is fluctuating. But GDP is increasing steadily. GDP is just a number. Let's take an example. See, imagine a plant grows for 5 centimeters in first day. It grows 2 centimeters in second day, 5 centimeters in third day. The overall length is increasing, the overall GDP is increasing, but the growth rate is fluctuating. So unless and until the growth rate is positive, the GDP number is going to be increasing. So there is a steady increase in GDP of India. That's a true statement. Answer is C, both 1 and 2. So 47th question with respect to GDP and GVA. So what is GDP according to new method? GDP is equal to GVA calculated at basic prices plus product tax minus product subsidy. This is according to new method. And this GVA at basic prices is nothing but the producer's prices. So apart from the factors of production, the producer is incurring some more expenditure. Like if he wants to start a business, he has to get a license for which he has to pay a fee. He has to pay professional tax. Whether he produces the product or not is immaterial. But during the production stage, he is facing some more expenditures, and that is called as production tax. And similarly, government at times give production subsidy, say for example free electricity. Taking all these into account is called as basic prices, right? So we know about GVA. So earlier we were taking into account of value of final goods and services. Now we are taking something called as GVA. So what is GVA? Let's take, I have wheat of 40 rupees, I convert it into bread of 100 rupees, I convert that into sandwich of 150 rupees. So what is the value addition made in each stage? Here the value addition is made for 60 rupees, here the value addition is made for 50 rupees. So add this 50, 60 and also the input product, that is going to be the gross value addition. So these gross value addition at basic prices is calculated and it is added to product tax and subtracted from product subsidy to get the GDP at market prices. This is a new method, right? So this GVA at basic prices or the gross value addition, this formula gives the picture of the economy from the producer's side, from the supplier's side, here from the producer's point of view. This GDP, whole GDP, is giving the picture of the economy from the demand side, from the consumer point of view, because all taxes are being added. So statement 1 and statement 2 are correct. So answer is C, both 1 and 2. 49th question, what is the primary objective of monetary policy? So before 2015, RBI was deciding the RBI governor was deciding the monetary policy, and he was vested with more tasks. He has to maintain price stability, he has to target inflation, he has to help in improving the growth, he has to maintain the positive exchange rate or stable exchange rate, and this was difficult for RBI. So now RBI and government, they have signed a monetary policy framework. Accordingly, RBI is going to target only inflation, not the growth and exchange rate, right? In 2016, RBI Act was amended, and now this monetary policy will not be decided by the RBI governor alone, rather it will be decided by RBI governor along with a committee of members, 3 from RBI side and 3 from government side. The committee headed by RBI governor, it has 6 members, and that monetary policy committee is going to target only price stability. So answer is A. 51st question, with respect to capital goods. So capital goods are final goods. So what is a final good? So final, any good which will not undergo any further transformation. Even it undergoes further transformation, it will not come into economic transaction, right? So let's take engine used in a car. This is getting transformed, it comes along with the final product, it comes again in the economic transaction. So engine is not a capital good. Computer or tractor, both are capital goods, both are final goods. They are not coming into economic transaction, but they are helpful in making final goods and services. So your answer is B, 2 and 3 only. 54th question, with respect to WPI. WPI takes into account of goods only, that's a true statement. Remember, CPI and GDP deflator takes into account of both goods and services. WPI takes into account of imported goods, that is also a true statement. WPI and CPI will take into account of imported goods, but GDP deflator will not take into account of imported goods. So here answer is both 1 and 2. 56th question, with respect to physical slippage. So what is physical slippage? When your actual physical deficit, if it is greater than the expected physical deficit, I call it as physical slippage. So it means that physical deficit is increasing than what we have planned. When physical deficit increases, that means expenditure is increasing. So which among the statements might lead to physical slippage? Either by increase in expenditure, we can expect more deficit, or decline in the revenue, that can also cause physical deficit, increase in physical deficit. GST rate cuts is going to reduce the revenue, so that will lead to physical deficit, that might lead to increase in physical deficit. Increase in revenue receipt will decline the physical deficit, so definitely not the B. Increase in market borrowing, remember, what is physical deficit? Budget deficit. Physical deficit is equal to budget deficit excluding debt creating capital receipts. So the capital receipts which creates a debt will not be included in calculating the physical deficit. So market borrowings are debt creating capital receipt, that will not be taken into account. So answer is A, GST rate cuts. 59th question, with respect to macroeconomic vulnerability index, it was introduced by Ministry of Finance in 2013-14, and this takes into account of all inflation, physical deficit, current account deficit. So an index will be calculated by taking into account of all inflation, physical deficit, current account deficit. And during the year 2013-14, India was having the highest macroeconomic vulnerability index. right? So any index or any macroeconomic vulnerability index which is less than 12 is relatively safe. Answer is D, all the above. 61st question with respect to GST Council, of course it is a constitutional body and every decision is based on majority of not less than 3/4 of weighted votes of members present and voting. That is also true. Any minister from the state can be nominated. Is it correct? Is it any minister or only finance minister? It is any minister. Any minister can be nominated by the state government to be a member of GST Council. All the statements are correct. Answer is D, 1, 2 and 3. 63rd question, answer is tax buoyancy. So what is tax buoyancy? It is the change in tax revenue with respect to change in GDP. That is an indicator to measure the efficiency and responsiveness of revenue mobilization in response to growth of GDP. A tax will be considered buoyant when the change in tax revenue is more than the change in GDP, or increase in, or the growth rate of tax revenue when it is more than the growth rate of GDP, I consider that tax as buoyant. So answer is C, tax buoyancy. 65th question with respect to primary deficit. So what is primary deficit? Primary deficit is equal to fiscal deficit minus interest payments, interest liabilities of the government. So when primary deficit on the higher, when primary deficit along with high fiscal deficit, a low primary deficit along with high fiscal deficit indicates interest liabilities are high. So how? Let's assume fiscal deficit is 100. Primary interest payments is some amount. It is said that a low primary deficit, let's assume primary deficit is 10. This means interest payments is going to be 90. A low primary deficit along with high fiscal deficit indicates that interest liabilities are not low, it is very high. When primary deficit equals to fiscal deficit, when PD is equal to FT, when interest payment is going to be zero. When interest payment is zero, the primary deficit will be equivalent to fiscal deficit. It means when PD is equal to FD, interest liabilities of the government are very, very low, or the interest liabilities are zero. So both the statements are wrong. So answer is C, both 1 and 2. 68th question, which among the following committee recommended the change in financial from existing April to March to January, December? It is Shankar Acharya committee. 70th question, so what is central sector scheme? Central sector schemes are completely funded by the central government. First statement is correct. Centrally sponsored schemes are shared by central government and the state government. Central government will transfer the fund to the state government and state government is going to implement this scheme. So B is also correct. And recently Niti Aayog constituted a committee headed by Chandra Babu Naidu, Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister, a committee of chief ministers, and they devised that the centrally sponsored schemes, not sector schemes, can be divided into core of core, core and optional schemes based on the importance level. Third statement is wrong. So answer is A, 1 and 2 only. 72nd question with respect to Goldilocks economy. So Goldilocks economy is an ideal economy where the growth rate will be moderate, inflation will be under control, and there will be more employment opportunities. All the monetary and fiscal policy will be devised to achieve a Goldilocks economy. So it is a situation in an economy where the monetary policy, fiscal policy becomes ineffective, no? Regulators use unconventional monetary policy to come out, no? Definitely no, they want Goldilocks economy. So both statements are wrong. So answer is D, neither one nor two. 74th question, here dividends will not come under capital receipt. Dividends are revenue receipts. We already saw any receipt which reduces the asset or creates liability is going to be coming under capital receipt. Dividends is not going to reduce your asset, that is just a profit, and it is not going to create any liability. So it is an example for revenue receipt. First statement is wrong. Strategic sale is nothing but disinvestment. If government disinvests more than 51% of the stake, when majority of the stake of the government is being disinvested, that is called a strategic sale. It is a way to privatization. Statement 2, strategic sale will result in not revenue receipt, rather capital receipt, because that reduces the asset. So here I have asked about not correct. So answer is C, both 1 and 2 are not correct. 76 question with respect to input tax credit of GST. So ITC is the tax refund which government gives to the business entity. We pay tax to government via business entity and government returns the tax. It gives the tax refund to the government business entity and government expects that this business entity should transfer the GST benefits to the consumers in terms of reduction in the prices in future transactions. So this tax refund is given by the government not to the end consumer, rather to the business entity in the supply chain. ITC offsets the tax paid for inputs from the tax payable on the final output produced. That's a true statement. Let's take in the supply chain A, B and C. B purchases a product from A and B sells the product from C. So B pays some tax and purchases the product and B sells the product and collects tax from the consumer. Now the same commodity which is being purchased from A is being sold to C and the same commodity is taxed twice. So the tax which is being taxed first will be refunded to B. This is nothing but tax on the input purchased by the B that is being sold to C. So input tax credit, that is why it is called as input tax credit, offsets the tax paid for the inputs from the tax payable on the final output. So the final output, the end consumer is going to pay a higher tax and this tax amount which is already paid during the input will be refunded. That is called as ITC. So answer is B, 2 only. In YouTube we have an exclusive channel called as Smart Leaders IAS Online, where I have made an exclusive video on GST anti-profit ring. So have a view on that, you will have better clarity. 78th question, World Economic Outlook report is released by IMF. They are going to rank the countries based on the GDP, which is calculated based on purchasing power parity, right? So answer is B, IMF. 79th question, what is capital gains tax? Let's assume I am purchasing a home for 10 lakh rupees in 2000. I am selling it for 1 crore in 2020. What is the gain made? 90 lakhs, for which I have to pay tax. It is called as capital gains tax. So this arises when there is an increase in sale of product. No. So sale of product, that is different. Here I have invested some amount in a particular commodity or land or anything that is being appreciated, and for the gain made I will be taxed. This is a direct tax, it is not indirect tax. So answer is D, neither one nor two. 81st question, which among the measures can be chosen to control the inflation? So to control inflation I have to reduce the money supply. Demonetization is the remotest measure to control the inflation because that is going to create a liquidity crunch that is going to contain inflation. Decrease in expenditure, of course, that is going to reduce the money supply. Increase in expenditure will increase money supply. Decrease in money expenditure, that is going to be a right measure during inflation to control it. Increase in tax rate for export and import. Exports tax rate has to be increased because already there is a higher demand in domestic market. When I export more, it will further influence the inflation. But imports, we already discussed in previous questions, import tax rate has to be reduced so that I can import more to match the excess demand. So here answer is, I have asked about measures, answer is A, 1 and 2 only. 83rd question is respect to composition scheme. So it is a scheme available for small and medium enterprises, not for all small and medium enterprises. Enterprises associated with service industry is not allowed except restaurant services. All other industries with respect to goods can opt for composition scheme if their turnover is less than 1.5 crores. And no ITC for composition scheme, that's a true statement. And the taxpayer is expected to pay only quarterly tax returns, and a firm under a composition scheme cannot engage in interstate state trade, that is also a true statement. So answer is C, 2, 3 and 4 only. 85th question, inflation slowing down over a period of time is called as disinflation. Remember, let's take this as inflation rate. This is time period. So this region where the price is increasing, I call it as inflation. And this period where the increase in prices is decreasing, I call it as disinflation. Remember, disinflation is not deflation, because at any point of time there is inflationary situation, but the trend is disinflationary. The trend is decline in prices is witnessed, but still there is inflationary situation. When it further goes below zero, when the inflation rate goes below zero, and if it is negative, that is called as deflation, and when it recovers, that is called as reflation. So your answer is B, disinflation. 87th question. The threshold limit for GST businesses, the annual turnover in the northeastern and hill states is 10 lakh rupees, and for rest of India it is 20 lakh rupees. So any business entity in northeastern and hilly states, if their turnover is more than 10 lakh rupees, they have to enroll in GST. Rest of India it is 20 lakh rupees. Answer is A. Remember, it is turnover and not the profit, it is turnover. So answer is A. 89th question, what is, which among the following is capital receipt? We already discussed, capital receipt will either reduce the asset or create liability, right? Recovery of loans is a capital receipt. Interest receipts is not a capital receipt, it is a revenue receipt. Purchase of bonds, it is a capital expenditure. I am spending to purchase bonds. You might ask, how recovery of loans? It is not reducing the asset or it is not creating liability. See, we have another clue to identify whether it is capital or not. When we are able to establish a two-way transaction, let's take, I pay tax, government is not repaying the tax to me. Only one-way transaction is revenue component. I pay, government pays salary to me and I am not repaying the salary to the government. One-way transaction, revenue component, government pays subsidies. The subsidies are given, not given back. One-way transaction. But in capital component, there will be two-way transaction. I borrow money, I have to repay. I lend money, I am going to get it back. I purchase an asset, I am going to sell it. Right? So answer is A, recovery of loans. 91st question with respect to GST. So GST is going to promote ease of doing business. It is going to increase organized trade. It is going to reduce logistical cost. How? One nation, one tax series. So there is a tax uniformity that is going to bring some uniformity in the tax policies, that is going to ease of, improve the ease of doing business. Increase in organized trade, if I want to get the benefit of tax refunds, I have to register under GST. So that is going to increase the organized trade. Reduce logistic cost, because of there is no octroi, there is no entry tax. So what is octroi, what is entry tax? So whenever a good enters a boundary or it crosses the border of the state will levy tax on the goods, that is called as entry tax. And whenever that good enters a local body, the local body will levy something called as octroi. And there is going to be a huge delay because of collection of these taxes in the entry of the state and entry of the local bodies. Imagine a truck traveling from Kanyakumari to Jammu and Kashmir has to cross many states, many local bodies. There is huge time delay. 60% of the transport time is spent on waiting period in this state borders. Now that is being eliminated, so that is going to reduce the logistic cost. So answer is D, 1, 2 and 3 only. 99th question, so what is blue economy? It is the sustainable use of ocean resources for economic growth. This is called as blue economy. Here it comes all, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all comes under blue economy. So answer is D, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. 100th question with respect to Financial Sector Development Council. So it was created in the year 2010. It is a super regulatory body which coordinates the activities of various financial regulators, SEBI, RBI, IRDA, PFRDA. So what is IRDA? Insurance Regulatory Development Authority. What is PFRDA? Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority. So these are the members of the Financial Stability Development Council, headed by Finance Minister. Right? Remember, RBI releases something called as financial stability report, a biannual report on behalf of FSDC, on behalf of Financial Stability Development Council. RBI releases a biannual report called as financial stability report, which deals about two things. It is going to give a general picture of the economic status of the country, and it is also going to give the picture of the banking sector in particular. So answer is A, finance minister. The next part of the video will be done by Suresh sir.